Creepshow. When the creator of Night of the Living Dead and Dawn of the Dead, you'll scream, ghastly ghouls. Cringe at weird kids. And shiver at the doings of evil doctors.
Hello, my name is Mike Fanning, and welcome to Special Effects. In this edition of Special Effects, we'll be taking a look at the new movie, Creepshow. The movie features a lot of current Hollywood stars like E.G. Marshall, Adrian Barbeau, Hal Holbrook, but the real star of the picture may be the man sitting next to me, Tom Savini, makeup man extraordinaire. Today we're going to be talking with Tom about the movie Creepshow and some of his work on other movies. Welcome, Tom.
Hi.
How you doing? Listen, Creepshow is an anthology of horror shows, and it's based on the old EC comics, the 1950 pulps. The movie seems kind of playful in its special effects, and I'm wondering how you achieve that. Could you give us some insight on that?
You mean why it's so playful?
Yeah.
Well, I think the script had a lot to do with that, because it was written by Stephen King. He's a playful guy. Mm-hmm. Sitting with Stephen King is like sitting with a 13-year-old kid, and you're talking about monsters and, you know, and Twilight Zone and things like that. And he's a multimillionaire, but it's like dirty T-shirts, purple boots, you know. But anyway, I think it's in his writing. He writes the way, it's very personal. If you've ever read any of his stuff, it's like the words he uses, and they're all in Creepshow, plus the fact that it's a comic book. You know? Mm-hmm. And
well, one of the things I noticed about the film was that there didn't seem to be a lot of gore splattering around.
No.
And it seemed that there was an illusion there, and it wasn't as awful as we might seem to think it was. And I'm wondering, what did you exactly do to achieve that type of effect?
Well, again, it was in the script. A lot of it was left up to the audience's imagination. The current trend in splatter movies, if I may, is like they want to show you everything, you know. They leave nothing to the audience's imagination. There is some gore in Creepshow, but in Creepshow, we use it to establish a horrific effect. And later on, we have the same monster doing and attacking somebody else, but we don't show you. Now, since you've already seen the attack on the other person, how grisly it was, you're about ready to turn your eyes when Fluffy, the monster, attacks again, but we don't show you. So you imagine it, and you imagine it more horrible than perhaps we can create it, you know, based on what you saw before. When we show you everything, that's it. That's all you ever see, and that's all your mind ever sees. But when your mind does it itself, it's like seeing an abstract painting that you complete, you know. You make it a little more beautiful or a little more horrible, you know.
Well, when you look at a script and you see it calls for certain creatures, what is the type of collaboration that goes on between you and the other creative people on the set? How do you decide what exactly you're going to do with one of your creations?
Well, that's the fun of it. Like in Creepshow, I've never made cockroaches burst out of a guy before. You know, the fun is inventing how to do that. With Fluffy, I wish I could recall the lines in the script. They said, we see a blur of fur, or we see a flash of teeth or something. That's all that was in the script, so that's the fun. My job was to invent how Fluffy should look. Now, I didn't want to make his mouth 3 feet wide, because maybe we wouldn't accept that as being a real creature. But if I made him ape-like or demonic, a demonic ape-like thing, or a Tasmanian devil, let's say, with a bigger mouth, but not such a big mouth, that's a little more believable. I knew he had to be old. I knew he had to be evil-looking and not funny-looking.
Well, one of the things...
I did a bunch of sketches. I had other artists do a bunch of sketches, and I submitted them all to George and Stephen King and Richard Rubenstein, the producer, and they picked my sketches, and so I went from there. Once they were satisfied with that, I knew I could go ahead and sculpt. That was the biggest thing, because I had to begin that right away. I had no idea how to do him. I knew it was going to take a long time, and there was no time to make any mistakes, you know.
So one of the things I've noticed about your creatures is that they're so real-looking, and I'm just wondering. I've read that you use such esoteric things as yak's hair, Rice Krispies, model airplane parts. I mean, how do you think these things up?
Well, I look at the thing, and I say, now, what would scare me? If I had to turn suddenly and see him sitting there, and I would do that. I would turn and picture him sitting there. And if he wasn't scary, I would keep turning until, well, what does he need? Does his eyebrows need to come down at more of an angle? You know, what? What do I need for me to see to be scared? And that's what the audience needs to see. So, getting back to the esoteric things, the materials, like this creature over there, the skull thing is Rice Krispies, corn chips, weeds from outside. I knew if a guy has been buried for 7 years and he comes back from the dead, he can't look all neat and slick, and my sculpture was looking neat and slick. So how do I make him look all crusty with globules of fungus and stuff? And we had Rice Krispies for breakfast one time, so I said, let me try this, and mix it up with some latex and some color, and it worked, so that's why it's on there, you know. Goodies, we call these new goodies that we find. I use surgical gloves inside of Fluffy's cheeks, you know, to puff the, well, I don't really, it's condoms in there, I don't know if I can say that, you know, for his cheeks to puff out, and they've been in there 2 years, and they're still working, so, it's just a matter of things around the house, you know.
Well, that brings me to another thing. Some of the creatures that you've had, they're very realistic, but then again, you have some creatures that are totally real, such as the cockroaches. Now, one repellent scene in the movie has all these cockroaches coming everywhere. Now, how did you get all these cockroaches, and how did you keep them under control?
I'd rather not talk about that, Mike. No, because I hate bugs. I mean, you hold up a spider, and you can have anything I have. You know, I'm just scared to death of spiders. Or razor blades. You know, they get me. The cockroaches were collected by two entomologists, Ray Mendez and David Brody. They went to Trinidad into these caves, and their stories about how they collected these roaches are scarier to me than any horror movie. I mean, it was really, I would never go in this cave. But anyway, those two guys went there. They collected these giant cockroaches, brought them back to Pittsburgh. They had a trailer, the bug motel, roach motel they called it, and they raised these roaches in these big garbage cans. And there's no way to train cockroaches. They would just release them, and hopefully they would do what we wanted them to do within the scene, like all head toward camera two or, you know, whatever. So they were real. I don't want to give away this, but hope by now the movie.
Oh, we'd love to have one secret.
The movie's been out, but when you see the scene at the end when they all came out of E.G. Marshall and the room is filling up with cockroaches, most of them are raisins and peanut shells that have been sprayed brown, and then we just dumped about 3,000 or 4,000 on top of all them. So if you see this big mass of stuff and all these roaches are moving around on top of it, the illusion is that the whole room is filled with roaches, you know.
Ah, there you have
another
it.
Illusion.
An exclusive for special effects. One thing I wanted to ask you about is the effect that other makeup artists have had on your career. Lon Chaney, for instance, the man of 1,000 faces, he has had a great influence on your career. And
well,
I was wondering if you could tell me
the reason I'm doing any of this is because of him. I saw a movie when I was 13 called Man of 1,000 Faces. That was what they called Lon Chaney. Kids in school used to say, don't step on that spider, it might be Lon Chaney. Really, because Lon Chaney was a silent screen star. In silent movies, the only tool an actor had to convey emotions was his body, his physical appearance, and what he did with it. His hands, his face, you know, they were always exaggerated. That's all they had to convey emotions. And since his parents were deaf mutes, he would come home from school and act out to his mother, who was deaf and dumb, all these things that happened to him during the day. All his life he would do that. So when he got into movies, I mean, he could act and convey such power, you know, behind his things, and pity. He could make you laugh, he could scare you, he could make you cry. Mm-hmm. So he became a big star. Also, he did his own makeup. He did his own stunts, and he was this fantastic actor, and I wanted to be Lon Chaney. When I was 13 years old, sitting in that theater, it wasn't like, oh, well, that's interesting. I'd like to try that someday. Or, I think I'll be a makeup artist when I grow up. I flipped out.
Your career at that point, didn't you?
That was it.
So what did you start doing, going out into the neighborhood? Or
I went home, and I stole a compact and a lipstick from my mother's purse. Left the money, you know. It was the purse, the makeup, and I looked for books. There was a scene in there where he became a pirate. I went to my aunt's house with this valise with a battered shirt and a headband and some brown makeup, and I said, watch this. And I put the makeup on, I put the headband on, and the tattered shirt, and I went, and they looked at me like, you know.
The poor kid.
He's deranged. This is a demented child, you know, my nephew here. They didn't understand I was being Lon Chaney, because I really flipped out. So the dream came true for me when I did Dawn of the Dead. I did the stunts, I was an actor in it, and I did all the makeup. To me, that was being Lon Chaney. When the talkies came in, and lots of silent screen actors, stars, faded away, Lon Chaney, who died shortly thereafter, but he did one talkie called The Unholy Three. It was a remake. where he was doing the voice of a ventriloquist dummy, the voice of a woman that he was playing, the voice of the ventriloquist doing the voice of the ventriloquist. Mm-hmm. He was starting to become Man of a Thousand Voices. Mm-hmm. We're getting off on a tangent, but anyway, Chaney, to me, that's where it all began for me.
Well, there, you have an old-time idol. Now, I understand that you have a modern-day idol in Dick Smith.
Dick Smith.
And might I ask, too, is there a camaraderie among makeup artists
nowadays? Absolutely. Dick Smith is the best makeup artist there is in the world. Rick Baker is next. Rick Baker won the Academy Award last year for American Werewolf. But Dick Smith invents a special effect technique, a blood formula, a latex appliance formula. He'll type it up, and he'll pass it on to Rick Baker, who will pass it on to Rob Bottin, who will pass it on to me. And then we improve on it, give it back when Dick Smith gets it back, and it's like, it's improved, and that it helps him. Mm-hmm. Also, it keeps the quality of the makeup in the movies today high, which is what he wants to do, Dick Smith. And there's no secrets. Mm-hmm. I'll call Rob Bottin and say, how did you do this? And he'll tell me, and I'll use it on my movie. And if he wants to find out how I blew up a head or something, he'll call me and I'll tell him, you know. He hasn't, but I'm just saying, there is a camaraderie mm-hmm. among the artists today.
Well, let's get back to your work now.
But what were you saying about Dick Smith? You were saying...
He's a modern-day idol for you, as opposed
right.
to...
Oh, I know. I called him recently because he's doing some introductory notes to a book I have coming out, okay? Mm-hmm. He said, and he called me back and says, listen, when you talk about me, for God's sake, keep it simple. Don't overdo it. Because every time I talk about him, I do overdo it. So he said, I says, oh, so you don't want me to call you God anymore, right? He says, no, Jesus is okay, but don't go overdo it. He's really a nice man.
Have you got a name for your new book yet, or is that
Grand Illusions, yeah. It's about special makeup effects in films. Films.
When will that be coming out?
Sometime in January.
Okay. Yeah. I wondered, I had read that you felt that your work on Creepshow would help eliminate that unwanted nickname that you have as King of the Splatter Makeup.
Ah, yes, the Splatter King. Yeah.
You've done some work on shows like Friday the 13th.
Friday the 13th,
Maniac,
Dawn of the Dead.
Burning.
Well, Maniac is probably the goriest movie that my effects have ever appeared in, okay? I mean, I get my head blown off inside the back seat of a car, a front seat of the car in that movie, plus a lot of other grisly things. But, yeah, we've all done the splatter movies. Dick Smith did The Sentinel. He swore he'd never do another blood movie again. Mm-hmm. He did Taxi Driver. Rick Baker did The Incredible Melting Man. He was ripping heads off, and he no longer will do any splatter movie. He'll pass it on to somebody who maybe will write him a letter and say, and show him pictures of their gore stuff. Mm-hmm. And they've gone on to now making monsters. I am lucky enough that I got to do Creepshow, where I can now do these monsters and get away from the splatter stuff. I mean, there's some gore in Creepshow, very little, but I hope to get my name disassociated with splatter. Mm-hmm. There's a book out called Splatter Movies. There's a whole chapter on me. And,
well, one thing I noticed while we were sitting here is this hand. And I wonder if you could show us just
this
for one
hand
moment.
Right?
Yeah, that hand.
Well, this is the Nate's corpse hand from Creepshow. It's the hand of the corpse that comes out of the grave in Father's Day that attacks biblical infant.
Well, I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to set up and show you some of the creatures around here. But why don't we take a look at this clip first? Now, this lovely creature here, Tom, it looks like my old girlfriend. Ah, yeah, that's her smile. That's terrific. Now, this creature, what scene is that from in the movie?
The opening scene, mm-hmm. where the specter appears at the window and beckons the little boy over and smiles at him and then points to the trash can, and then we go into animation. This is the specter in the window. He had a costume on that was blowing, and the full moon was behind him. And
is there anything else you can do with that? Did you go through the full range of expression with this?
Oh, yeah. We had 11 people operating this guy.
11?
Yeah. You know, one person with a smile, one person with the eyes, one person with the hands, the wind machine, the moon, the clouds in front of the moon.
Great looking. Yeah. Well, let's move down here and take a look at this creature right here. Now, I know you affectionately call this creature Fluffy.
That's right.
Now, how can such a bizarre-looking creature be called Fluffy?
Well, it's a contrast in terms. Mm-hmm. Here's this mean little ugly monster who eats Adrian Barbeau in three bites, and they nicknamed him Fluffy, like a little kitty cat.
Now, what can this particular head do?
Oh, he does a range of things. Let me show you here. First of all, he breathes. And what's this? This is eyebrows. This is getting sticky here. There's eyebrows going down. A combination of the brows going down and the mouth snarling like that. Like, you know, and the eyes going up and down. This is getting sticky. Or he opens his bottom lip and he opens his mouth. We knocked out a tooth a little earlier.
Now, I understand that these teeth are very sharp.
Very sharp.
Now, what are they made out of?
I took a cast from the fangs of a gorilla skull and just made a whole bucket of gorilla fangs, and then we filed them down different lengths, and all of his teeth are just the fangs of an actual male gorilla skull.
Now, I understand that some mechanical creatures in movies, they don't look real because they don't drool and things like that.
Ah, that's right. I saw King Kong, and it was a beautiful gorilla, but every time he opened his mouth, it was very dry in there, you know, like should have been wet. So this particular tube right here, we pumped glycerin through it right behind the two front teeth, and he was always dripping.
So it came out right in here?
Yeah, right behind the two front teeth there, yeah. And the actor wore this. He had special lenses in his eyes so that the monster's eyes were actually the actor's eyes, so he could move the eyes around, and he would open the mouth. Mm-hmm. All the other expressions were operated off camera.
Now, that must have been an incredibly uncomfortable experience for the fellow inside the
costume. Oh, yeah, sure, but he liked it. You know, you take an inhibited, mild-mannered person, you put a gorilla mask on them, and in like 15 seconds, they're swinging off chandeliers and hunched over and trying to be the monster, because they're free. Nobody knows who they are, they can get away with anything, and they're this gorilla. They become the mask. Well, he loved being this 3-foot-high Tasmanian devil. And also, every 15 minutes, we had to take the eyes out, just for his own comfort. Mm-hmm. Sometimes he wouldn't let us do it because it would have meant taking the whole head off. He just wanted to stay, you know, as the monster.
And this is only one of three Fluffies that you did for the movie?
Right. There was
Why three?
Well, for the attack scenes, we had a puppet Fluffy. And for the underwater scene, we had to make a head. I didn't want to put this underwater. Mm-hmm. So I built another head and put a scuba regulator inside so the actor, when he was in there, he just wore the mask and the hands so he could breathe, you know. Mm-hmm. And so we wouldn't destroy this mask. That's why there was a third Fluffy.
I see. Why don't we move down to this creature right here? Okay. And I think I recognize that old fellow there.
Yeah, this is Nate's corpse, the guy that says, "I want my cake, Bedelia." See the stringy stuff in the mouth?
Yeah, what's
this
that?
This is, it's just latex, but we did this because the movie is from the EC comic books, and every time there was a nasty creature, an ugly guy, he had this stringy stuff in his teeth. So, I mean, half of it's gone right now, but the actor wore this, and he could open and close the jaw. Except for the maggot scene. He wouldn't put this on and let us put maggots on it. I didn't blame him. I said, don't do it. So we got this girl to do it for the scene, the close-up of when the maggots are on it.
Now, what are some of the items that went into making up this creature? I think I saw some Rice Krispies.
These are Rice Krispies. This is all acrylic paint and latex and cotton and yak hair. It looks hard, but this is all foam rubber. This bony substance is sculpted and then reproduced in foam.
How about the teeth there?
The teeth are real teeth that a dentist would use in making a dental plate for somebody. Mm-hmm. They're plastic, acrylic, and they were part of the sculpture when I made it, and then just added them in later when I had the foam out of the oven.
That's charming. Well, let's move on down.
This is, if you've seen Friday the 13th, this is the Betsy Palmer head that is chopped off at the end of the movie. It's a quick shot where Betsy Palmer assumes the expression of the fake head as the machete swings, and we cut back to her, it's the fake head, and then it just gets lopped off.
Jeez. Now, did you have to make a mask of Betsy Palmer for that?
Sure, she was great. We had to cover her whole head in plaster and then to make the mold, and then the head was duplicated from the mold in foam rubber.
Well, speaking of Friday the 13th and movies like that, what's your philosophy on gore on the screen? How do you feel about that?
Well, I don't know if this is psychologically sound or not, but when I was a kid growing up and watching TV and movies, let's say there's the Lone Ranger, and here's the Lone Ranger with a .45, and it shoots somebody, and they went, ah, and they fell down. Mm-hmm. Neat, slick, murder wasn't ugly, it was easy, you know? today you got to turn your eyes away from the screen. We show the gore and the blood the way it really was, you know. And like, again, I don't know if it's psychologically sound, but mm-hmm. I think the more we condition kids that it's ugly and hideous and nasty, that it's a turnoff, mm-hmm. you know, I hope.
Well, as far as your work on these movies, you've actually turned down some movies, haven't you, that feature sure. excessive gore?
Sure. The Crazy Ugly Maniac that rapes and kills pretty women in the woods, I turned that one down. No, that's not a real movie. But they're getting that blatant, so obvious. I got a script the other day called The Bloodthirsty Monster. I got one called The Blind Date, where this guy pushes his girlfriend's face into a Cuisinart. You know? But that's the difference. That's the only difference between the wave of splatter movies that was happening was the murder weapon. You know, mm-hmm. the murder, it was always killing these independent people, you know, but the difference was the weapon, a pitchfork, a shears, a Swiss Army knife, you know. Mm-hmm. They overdid it.
Now, you have worked before in, well, you were actually a combat photographer in Vietnam, uh-huh. and you've been credited by some people as having anatomical correctness in a lot of your creatures.
Yeah.
Did any of that come through your Vietnam experience?
Oh, sure, sure, but some people said that it began my interest in gore. When I see something gory on the screen and I go, ah, beautiful. It wasn't because it was gory. Because it worked. It was an illusion, a magic trick, a technological thing that worked, you know. And maybe that's why I'm so detached from it, because that's how I see it. So when I'm showing people this stuff and my artistic achievements, and they go, boy, you're sick. You're demented. You know.
And when you refer to yourself sometimes as a magician.
That's right.
What you're doing is a sleight of hand.
Just a magician. I'm using mechanical devices and misdirection on this blank screen that you see and fooling you. I mean, that's all I think I'm doing is like fooling people. However, being in Vietnam gave me first-hand anatomical knowledge, let's say, okay? There's a difference between the real thing and a fake head or something, okay? This isn't a good example, but there's a feeling that you get. It's a visceral feeling when you was a real human being that this happened to. It's really, you know, if I don't kind of feel that when I'm creating something, that realism, it's not real enough to me, you know? Mm-hmm. And that's, I guess, why I have this Splatter King thing, you know. It's like my stuff is realistic.
Mm-hmm. Well, now, you've worked on a number of Romero films. You've worked on Martin. You've worked on Dawn of the Dead. You've worked on Night of the Living Dead. And you had a feature part
I didn't do Night of the Living Dead, but I did do Dawn.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. But you did have a feature part in Knight Riders.
Yeah. Well, there was no gore. That was a love story, and that was a trip.
Well, how did you like that? Because obviously that was a great...
I loved makeup. Sitting off the set, and Mr. Savini, we're ready for, oh, please call me Tom. Yeah, but we're ready for you now, and not having to worry about a deadline for getting a monster ready, you know. Mm-hmm. It was like I was in my costume, I was the Black Knight, that was, you know, was my chance to be Basil Rathbone, or, you know. I always try to play a part in the films that I do effects in, you know, small, whatever.
And George afforded you that...
George lets you... As an actor, he lets you improvise. The whole part I played in Dawn of the Dead was improvised, and he wanted to see more of it. As far as special effects go, he lets you improvise. Like in Dawn of the Dead, we were sitting around thinking, what's a unique way of killing somebody? We'd think of it, and we'd go to George and say, how about if we take an umbrella? And, you know, and George would go, all right. 2 hours later, we'd do it. You know, he's just that easy to create for, you know.
Well, now, you've told us that Lon Chaney was your idol, Man of a Thousand Faces. Now, one thing I'm puzzled about you is that it seems like you're a man of a thousand faces, because not only have you acted and done makeup, but now I understand that you've recently had an offer to direct.
Oh, yeah.
Could you tell us a little bit about
that?
Yeah,
from William Friedkin. He had a script called Night of the Full Moon, and it was big budget. Well, it was low budget today, you know, but it was a mystery thriller movie, and I turned it down to do Creepshow out of loyalty to George and... Well, basically, out of loyalty to George. I'd like to still do it again someday. It hasn't been done, you know, if he's still interested. Bill?
Well, if you had the chance to direct, what type of film would you go after?
Oh, I'd love to remake, say, Trapeze. Did you ever see Trapeze?
No.
Burt Lancaster, Tony Curtis? It's a love story. It's a great love story. I'd like to do that. I'd like to remake Man of a Thousand Faces using the primitive materials that Lon Chaney did use to achieve those wonderful monster characters. Mm. Play Chaney, perhaps. That would be the ultimate dream come true for me, because that's where it all began for me, with that movie. I'd like to do something with monsters, if it's possible. I mean, that's where it all began. It was easy when I was a kid The easiest thing to do with makeup was to do monsters. You buy famous monsters of film land and try to recreate those monsters. Yeah. It was three-dimensional, you know.
One thing I did, well, I always bought those little models, painted them up faithfully.
Sure. Me too.
Of course, I did it with day glow so that I could go to sleep at night and they'd scare the heck out of me.
Or you could still see them with the lights on.
That's true. Well, as far as other projects now, you've talked about directing, you've talked about makeup. What do you have in the near future? What type of projects are you looking at?
Now I'm working on my book, you know, about makeup effects. And when that's out sometime in January, I think there's a script on its way from an independent producer named Ralph Cadero that involves a 30-foot creature. You know, I haven't got the script yet, so I don't even know if I'm going to... I'd like to do that because it involves monsters and not splatter, you know.
Well, speaking of monsters, I think we've forgotten one of our monsters.
Oh, yeah, the fluffy puppet that we were talking about.
Well, let's move on down here.
Yeah.
And this particular creature right here is fluffy number two. Ah! Gee!
That's a good example. Oh. See, now, those teeth are rubber. They won't hurt you. He was made so that we could actually have the fluffy face physically him attack Adrian Barbeau. When he bit the student under the staircase, the chunk that he bites out of the student was actually attached with Velcro to the roof of Fluffy's mouth. Mm. So that he would make contact, and then when he moved away, he would the piece would come off in Fluffy's mouth and pump blood into that area.
Ah, so that is what are these teeth made out of?
They're foam latex. I made a cast of the real Fluffy head here, of his teeth, like a dentist would. Mm-hmm. And I just poured foam latex in that mold and baked it in an oven. In his tongue. See, now, in the other head, the tongue helps to hide the actor's chin and lower lip in there because the mouth opens when the actor moves his lower jaw up and down. Presses on a cup that opens the mouth.
Right.
And these are the way. He had special lenses that looked like this in his eyes. And so I just took some glass eyes, repainted them, and stuck them in there. It's always a quick shot. You can't dwell on him too much for a close-up. Mm-hmm. It's always a quick shot of him turning and attacking and the teeth biting somebody.
So it's the magician in you.
It's the illusion, yeah.
The sleight of hand.
That's right.
Well, I think we have time for one more question.
From the audience? Anybody out there? No.
What I'd like to ask you is, I know there are a lot of aspiring makeup artists out there, a lot of kids that have watched you, have read about you in magazines. Uh-huh. What kind of advice can you give to these kids out there?
Well, if they sculpt and if they can sketch, that's a great help to them. If not, it's going to be a problem. But not really, because you can get other people to storyboard things for you. If you're not a sculptor, I would suggest taking blobs of clay and moving it into shapes and seeing, you know, it'll teach you just by doing that. You've got to get Richard Corson's book on stage makeup, which is the Bible of basic makeup. There's some effects in that book too, foam latex, how to cast a head. That's required reading. You've got to read that and know what you're talking about there. Take pictures of everything, keep those pictures, find out where and when pre-production is starting on certain films, send those pictures in, because they work from files like that. Mm-hmm. They look at your work, they call you in and look at it. Being in the right place at the right time is how I did it. I mean, I was just lucky. I was in Pittsburgh, George Romero lives there, he did movies, I went down there, hey, sure, we'll hire you. Showed him my portfolio, and that was that.
And if there was one quality that maybe you have that other people might try to have, what would that be?
I was always into... Oh, patience, sure, but that's, even if you don't have it, you learn it, you know. Mm-hmm. But I was always into sleight of hand and fooling people, scaring people by that. Mm-hmm. So, because that's what all this, these are all illusions, you know. I would say if you can think in those terms of how to fool people, make people look here while you're doing something behind your back, you know.
Well, the sleight of hand is with us now because we're out of time.
Ah.
And Tom, I've got to thank you for being here.
My pleasure,
here.
Thank you.
And I look forward to your next project with a lot of anticipation.
Thank you.
And we're going to say goodbye for now, and I hope you join us next time for Special Effects. Mm-hmm.